Hello and welcome to Clinical Society meeting. Today in the CSM, the presentations are from Department of Tuberculosis and Respiratory Diseases and Faculty of Dental Sciences. The first presentation is from Department of Tuberculosis and Respiratory Diseases, and the case titled is Scars of a Long Battle. And it will be moderated by Head of the Department, Professor G.N. Srivastava sir. And the second presentation, which is from Faculty of Dental Sciences, the case title is Correction of Dentofacial Deformity, an Interdisciplinary Approach. And it will be moderated by Dr. Akhilesh Kumar Singh. He is an associate professor in Faculty of Dental Sciences. So over to Professor G.N. Srivastava, sir, for further proceeding. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Pandey. Good morning to Director IMS, sir, my colleague, and my students. Today, on behalf of Department of Chest, we are going to present a very interesting case, which is very much interesting for the present scenario. Every clinician are facing the same problem, and that is the scar of a long battle. Presentation will be done Dr. Suresh Aparna. She is third year resident, and now I hand over to Dr. Suresh, third year.
Respected Director, sir, teachers, seniors, juniors, and my dear colleagues, today I'm here to present the Clinical Society meet on behalf of Department of TB and Respiratory Diseases. The session is moderated by our professor and HOD, Dr. G.N. Srivastava, sir. Our case is titled The Scars of a Long Battle. Presenting complaints, a 35-year-old male resident of Varanasi presented to us on 31-5-2021 with chief complaints of shortness of breath, cough, and right-sided chest pain for 1 week duration. History of presenting illness. Patient presented with complaints of shortness of breath for the past 7 days. It was insidious in onset, gradually progressive, MMRC grade 4, persistent in nature, and was associated with postural variation, wherein the shortness of breath worsens on lying down supine position. There was no diurnal variation. He also gives a history of cough for 1 week duration, which was insidious in onset, gradually progressive, non-productive. There was no diurnal or postural variation of cough. He also complained of right-sided chest pain for past 1 week that was dull, aching, diffuse, and non-radiating. There was no relation with food intake, and there was no aggravating or relieving factors. There was no history of palpitation, syncope, orthopnea, generalized body swelling, fever, sore throat, headache, burning, micturition, rash, or any history of recent trauma. Past history, our patient had a history of cough, fever, sore throat for 1 week duration during the month of January 2021. His COVID RT-PCR was done during that time and was negative. He took a course of oral antibiotics, azithromycin 500 mg for 5 days, and symptomatic treatment, after which he improved. In April 2021, our patient developed fever, cough, malaise, for which he was advised COVID RT-PCR, which was positive on April 7th. He took treatment from home for 3 days with oral medications initially after consulting a local practitioner, but his symptoms worsened, and hence he was hospitalized in a local hospital's ICU and was given oxygen therapy via high-flow nasal cannula initially for 7 days, but his condition deteriorated and he was put on non-invasive ventilation. He was on NIV for 15 days and was gradually weaned off, and after 1 month of hospital stay, he was discharged on home oxygen and other medications. There was no history of diabetes, hypertension, coronary artery disease, tuberculosis, or any recurrent childhood infection in the past. Family history. There was no history of similar illness in the family or COVID-19 among close family members. Treatment history, as stated through the patient and from the documents available, he was on following medication post-discharge after COVID-19. Domiciliary oxygen via nasal prongs at 2 to 3 liter per minute. Trabprednisolone 20 mg for 1 week once daily, followed by 10 mg OD next week, and then he stopped it. Antifibrotic tab nintedanib 150 mg BD, tab aspirin 75 mg OD, tab vitamin C 500 mg BD, and tab B complex once daily. Personal history, he works as a counter salesman in a garment shop. He is married, have two healthy children, non-smoker, non-alcoholic, consumes mixed diet. On general examination, our patient was well-built, conscious, he was dyspneic and irritable. His GCS was E4, V5, M6 at the time of presentation. His vitals were respiratory rate 32 per minute, thoracoabdominal type, SpO2 81% in room air and 95% with 5 liter per minute oxygen via face mask. Blood pressure 104 by 62 millimeters of mercury, right arm supine position, and pulse rate 106 per minute. His BMI was 31.1 kilogram per meter square. There was no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, pedal edema, lymphadenopathy. JVP was not raised. Systemic examination was within normal limits. Coming to the examination of the respiratory system, examination of the upper respiratory tract, nasal cavity, nasal flaring was present, no nasal congestion, deviated nasal septum, secretions, polyps or mass, oral cavity, poor oral hygiene, dental caries was present in the left second lower molar teeth, no oral ulcers or tonsillar enlargement, pharynx, no evidence of pharyngitis. But coming to the examination of the lower respiratory tract, on inspection, trachea appears to be shifted to the left side, trail sign was positive. Shape of the chest was bilaterally symmetrical, chest wall movements was reduced on the right side compared to the left, apical impulse was not visible, there was no drooping of shoulder, intercostal hollowing or fullness, use of accessory muscles was present. On palpation, there was no local rise in temperature tenderness. Trachea was shifted to the left side. There was reduced chest movement on the right side compared to left. Vocal fermeters was decreased on right side in all areas and in left side in infrascapular, infraaxillary, and mammary areas. Apex beat was felt in the left fifth intercostal space, 1 centimeter lateral to the midclavicular line. Measurements, chest expansion was 2 centimeter, anteroposterior diameter 27 centimeter on the right side and 26 centimeter on the left side. Transverse diameter was 37 centimeter. On percussion, hyperresonant note was heard in right side over all areas and in left side, infraaxillary, mammary and infrascapular areas, there was no shifting dullness. On auscultation, in right side, air entry was decreased in right side in all areas and in left side, air entry was decreased in mammary, infraaxillary and infrascapular areas. There was no added sound. Vocal resonance was decreased in all areas in right side, in the left side, mammary, infraaxillary and infrascapular areas. After history and clinical examination, our differential diagnosis were first was bilateral pneumothorax post-COVID and second was bilateral bullous lung disease post-COVID. Investigations at admission, hemoglobin 11, total count was 20,260, it was neutrophilic predominant, LFT and RFT was within normal limits, viral markers were sent, HIV, HBsAg, HCV was non-reactive, ECG showed sinus tachycardia, cardiac profile was normal, COVID RT-PCR was negative, D-dimer, ferritin, IL-6, CRP, LDH was sent, PFT couldn't be done, and ABG at admission showed pH of 7.43, PO2 81, PCO2 51, and bicarb of 31.
Dr. Aparna, sorry to interrupt you here. The provisional diagnosis which you have kept just points favoring the endpoints against the diagnosis.
The first diagnosis
investigation. Come to that diagnosis slide, the differential diagnosis slide.
Yes, sir. The first diagnosis was bilateral pneumothorax and our patient, from the history, our patient complains of right-sided chest pain, dyspnea and dry cough for 1 week duration. It was a short history and in examination, we were getting reduced chest movements in the right side and there was hyperresonance note all over in the right side and in the left side in infraaxillary, infrascapular and mammary areas. And there was air entry which was decreased in the right side, all areas and left side in the inframammary, the mammary infraaxillary infrascapular areas, and also vocal resonance and vocal fermeters was decreased, which favors pneumothorax. And our second diagnosis is a bilateral bulla's lung disease. Again, the bulla and pneumothorax have similar clinical findings, and so we kept it as a second diagnosis, sir.
Okay.
So this was a chest x-ray that was present with our patient. This was the first chest x-ray that was taken on 5th January 2021. And at this time, the patient was RT-PCR negative. And here we can see that there is heterogeneous opacification in the right lower zones with blunting of the costophrenic angle. Other parenchyma appears to be normal. This is a second chest x-ray, and this was taken when he was COVID positive on 10th April. And here we can see that there is bilateral heterogeneous opacification and bilaterally in upper, mid and lower zones, more in the lower zones. And parenchyma is, compared to this thing, there are more infiltrates. And this is another chest x-ray which was taken on 12th May after discharge during follow-up. And at this time, there is again infiltrates, and here we can see an hyperlucent area in the right lower zone. And this is a chest x-ray that we took and during admission, and it shows multiple bulla in the right side, and it is causing the mediastinal shift. There is both structural shift and apex is also shifted, with a pneumothorax in the left side, and also opacities are present in the left upper and mid zone. This is a CT chest which was already available with the patient. It was taken on 27th April. And here also we can see that there is bilateral GGOs, more in the upper, mid and lower zone, mainly in the lower zones, which is subpleural and centrilobular in location. Now we give treatment. We give oxygen support with face mask at 5 liter per minute. Nebulization with levosalbutamol, ipratropium, budesonide, stat was given, followed by Q8-ALI. Anticoagulation with enoxaparin was started at the dose of 40 milligrams subcutaneously OD. Antifibrotic perfenidone was started, 267 milligram TDS. Steroid IV methylprednisolone, 40 milligrams stat. Antibiotic is given injection piperacillin tazobactam 4.5 gram IV Q8-ALI, pantoprazole and ondansetron was also given, and other supportive treatment including IV fluids, cough suppressants, analgesics and nursing care. Considering the gross disparity between the previous chest x-ray CT scan with the current chest radiograph, we went ahead with the HRCT thorax for more diagnostic clarity. Now I request Dr. Ashish Verma sir, professor and head of department radio diagnosis, to give us expert opinion on this chest x-ray, HRCT thorax. Ashish Verma sir, kindly give your expert opinion on the HRCT thorax.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah, thank you. So basically, as she has already described, this was the HRCT thorax on admission. I think when the patient came to them, and as we can very well see, the right side lung is almost totally, barring a small part, most of the lung is totally replaced by large air-containing cystic areas. And there are residual fibrotic bands in between those areas, and rest of the whole of the right hemithorax is replaced by those air containing cysts. Now whether they are bulla or whether they are areas of pneumothorax resulting from destruction of lung, that needs to be proven. On the left side, similar areas are seen, but they are much less in significance and distribution. And the lung parenchyma, which is seen in between those areas, show fibrotic bands and interstitial prominence. So that means that on the right side, the disease went a bit way ahead to destroy the whole of the lung, while on the left side, some part of the lung was only involved. On the left side, notably, if we can see on the lateral right, middle of the carina, there is a loculated pneumothorax, which is there, and which is associated with compressed band of the lung. So those were the findings which are quite in favor of post-COVID Buller's disease or post-COVID changes in the lung in a chronic form. Thank you. Yeah, you can carry on, please.
Okay, so thank you, sir. So then,
Ashish Verma, is there any component of fibrosis in the CT scan?
Yes, there is component of fibrosis. You can see fibrotic bands in the right residual part of the right lung as well as in the left lung. So fibrosis is also there, definitely.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. So if we do a comparison of the both CTs, that is CT taken on 27th April and CT at admission, we can see that all these GGOs are replaced by multiple bulla and there is loculated pneumothorax, as sir has explained. So this was the report, and it was in favor of a vanishing lung syndrome with compressive atelectasis and pneumothorax as described. So a final diagnosis after history, clinical examination and HRCT was a right-sided vanishing lung syndrome with left pneumothorax etio post-COVID. So we repeated the investigations on day 3 and total count was 17,120. It was decreasing. The inflammatory panel came and it was all raised, and HbA1c was 5, alpha 1 antitrypsin was 88, MCD collagen was also within normal limits, 2D echo was done, and which is also normal. By day 3 evening, our patient went into severe respiratory distress. His SpO2 was 84% in face mask with reservoir bag at 15 liter per minute. His respiratory rate was 30 per minute. ABG was done and it showed severe ARDS. So he was shifted to ICU immediately and was started on oxygen therapy with high flow nasal cannula. He was put on antibiotics, levofloxacin, clindamycin and cefepiram sulbactam, and anticoagulation and antifibrotics was continued. He was gradually weaned off from HFNC and was patient was shifted back to a ward with face mask in reservoir bag at 10 liter per minute. And this was the chest x-ray which we repeated on the 14th day of admission, that is after patient came from ICU. And here we can see that the bulla is persisting in the right side with mediastinal shift, and in the left side we can see that the pneumo component has decreased. There is resorption of air and features of fibrosis such as diaphragmatic pulling, rib crowding and opacities. And these are the, we repeated the investigation on day 14 and day 18, and it was also encouraging. We shifted the patient on face mask on day 16 and he was maintaining saturation. D-dimer was still elevated. So PT-INR came to be within normal limits. Color Doppler of the bilateral lower limb was within normal limits. Bronchoscopy was done on day 21 and BAL was sent for RM culture, KOH, AFB and CVNAC, and it was also normal. Our patient was closely monitored. By day 21, we shifted the patient to nasal bronchs and he was maintaining a saturation of 94% to 96% with 3 liter per minute of O2, which was gradually waned. And by day 28, he was maintaining saturation of 97% and 2 liter per minute of oxygen via nasal bronchs. After 1 month, he was discharged on domiciliary oxygen along with antibiotics, anticoagulants, antifibrotics with regular advice of SpO2 monitoring and was kept on regular follow-up. So this is an HRCT which we done during the follow-up, and here we can see that the bulla is persisting in the right side, but there is significant improvement in the left side. And if you do a head-to-head comparison between the first CT, that was the outside CT, the CT taken during admission and the follow-up CT, we can see that the apical bulla and the pneumo component which was present at admission was disappeared during the follow-up, but the right side bulla was persisting. So this is the follow-up CT. Now coming to the literature, what is bulla's lung disease? A bulla is an air-containing space within the lung parenchyma that arises from destruction, dilatation, and confluence of air spaces distal to the terminal bronchioles, and it is larger than 1 centimeter in diameter. Bulla can occur in various clinical contexts. It can occur with emphysema, which is called as bullous emphysema. It can occur in cases of pulmonary fibrosis, as in later stages of sarcoidosis or complicated pneumoconiosis. In vanishing lung syndrome, where the parenchyma is rapidly replaced by multiple bullae, and in lungs that are otherwise normal. So this is a classification, and it could be primary, as we see in vanishing lung syndrome, secondary with emphysema, associated with pulmonary fibrosis, as in cases of sarcoidosis or TB, or familial disorders like alpha-1 antitrypsin or Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. There are three types of bulla: type 1, type 2, type 3. Type 1 bulla mainly in the apices, narrow neck with no content. Type 2 bulla mainly in the mid zones with panafysina or emphysema is the content with a broad neck. Type 3 bulla again favors the lung basis, which even broader neck, and it also has a content of panafysina or emphysema. Now, how these bulla are formed? This is a normal SNI, this is a cross section, and this is a bulla. So how these bulla are formed? There are various hypotheses. The first hypothesis is a weakness of the alveolar wall, which predisposes the formation of the bulla, mainly in the upper lobe where the pleural pressures are most negative. It can also occur in the inflammatory diseases of the bronchioles that leads to progressive air trapping in tension air spaces. It can also occur due to underlying paraseptal emphysema. And also it can occur in cases of fibrosis where the scar tissue formation, which traps the areas of normal lung and enlarges air spaces by traction on the surrounding intact alveoli. Now coming to my second diagnosis, vanishing lung syndrome. It is the vanishing lung syndrome or giant bullous emphysema or type 1 bullous disease is defined as a larger bulla which is occupying at least one third of the hemithorax. It is coined by Burke in 1937 and usually it affects male less than 35 years of age. Risk factor includes smoking, marijuana abuse, alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency. Pathophysiology,
I think the presentation time is over. So now we can start the discussion.
Yes, sir.
Question.
Sir, we will take two, three more slides only.
Two, three slides, sir.
Okay.
So this is the treatment could be medical or surgical. And coming to the post-COVID part, post-COVID is some symptoms that continue beyond 12 week of illness. And here, post-COVID pulmonary syndromes, it can affect the airway, parenchyma, pleura, or pulmonary vasculature. And who are high-risk people for these post-COVID syndromes? Elderly patient, patient with comorbidities, patient requiring domiciliary oxygen, patient put on NIV, or patient with pre-existing illness. Why post-COVID syndromes? It could be due to persistent viremia, due to inflammatory weak antibody response, relapse and reinfection, deconditioning. And what are the predictors of these illness, which includes, as we discussed, the advanced stages and alcohol or prolonged ICU stay, in markers of inflammation such as IL-6, CRP or LDH. And this is the ARDS fibrosis, that is ARDS and COVID-19 leads to diffuse alveolar damage. And we have an exudative stage, proliferative stage, and the fibrotic stage. And in the fibrotic stage, we can get features like bronchiectasis, microcystic air spaces, and tractional bronchiectasis. And this fibrosis is usually improving, but in some cases, it can lead to progressive. And this case, we can go for antifibrotics. A few case reports. This is a study which was similar to our case, and it showed
Dr. Aparna, I think 3-4 slides are already over, so moving to because we have limited time, so we have to stop your presentation here. So I request Professor Sanjeev Kumar Gupta, sir, you can unmute and ask your question.
Thank you, Abhishek. This patient was a 35-year-old gentleman with no history of smoking, non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, and yet he has a very severe consequence of COVID. So I just wanted to know what treatment, where was he hospitalized for COVID and what treatment did he receive? You have not mentioned in your presentation. And what was his immunization status post, he got the infection in April.
Yes,
so
sir.
Did he receive any doses of vaccine or not? That you have not mentioned. And finally, what is the long-term outcome? Is he a candidate for lung transplantation?
He's alive.
Thank you, sir, for your question. So the first part of the question, he was admitted in a local hospital here in Varanasi. And first, initially, during his treatment phase, he was taking treatment from home, but his condition deteriorated and he was hospitalized in the ICU. Initially, he was kept on HFNC, then he was kept on NIV. He received steroids, antifibrotics, oxygen therapy, antibiotics, and anticoagulation at that treatment. And post-discharge also, he was kept kept on domiciliary oxygen and antifibrotics and antibiotics was continued, and he also took a course of oral steroids post discharge also, and he was not immunized, and then he came to us at that after 1 month on May 31st, sir.
And is he a candidate for lung transplantation now?
Actually, sir, there are few case reports that have already reported where there is a spontaneous resolution of the size of the bulla, and we call it as autobullectomy. So both of the hypothesis behind this autobullectomy is that after the healing phase of viral pneumonitis, there is loss of communication between the bulla and the airway, and there is spontaneous resorption of the air. So 4 to 5 months we are keeping him in a conservative treatment, and as I've already in this patient also, his left side bulla and this thing has completely resolved. So after the 5 months of period, we'll assess it, and if it is a multiple bulla, then we can go for a segmentectomy, lobectomy, or pneumonectomy, and if it is not, then we have to consider for other option. And he's on still follow-up, sir.
Thank you.
I request Professor Ajay Khanna, sir, you can unmute and ask your question. Dr. Anand, you can. Yes, Professor Ajay Khanna, sir. Sir, you are not audible. Dr. Anand, you can unmute and you can ask your question.
Yeah, hello. Good morning. It was really a nice case, nice presentation. I just want to know that all the history and initial examination part is suggestive of almost all the signs and symptoms are limited to the right side of chest only. So why that in the differential it was kept as a bilateral disease? Because the initial x-rays is showing only disease on the right side, initial x-rays, but only on the basis of CT you can say it's a bilateral disease, but it is very difficult to say early on the basis of history and examination that it's a bilateral disease.
So in the thank you, sir, for your question. So in the examination part also, we have mentioned that in the left side, in the infrascapular, infraaxillary, and mammary areas, there was hyperresonant nodes, air entry was decreased, and vocal fermetus and vocal resonance was decreased, sir. So that is why we kept bilateral pneumothorax and bilateral bullous lung disease as the differentials after history. Right side, there was whole involvement, and in the left side, there was findings in the lower areas of the lungs. So that is why we kept those two different and bilateral disease after history and clinical examination itself, sir, and which later got proved on the radiological investigations.
Oh. Professor Ajay Khanna, sir, if you can unmute and ask your question. So I am reading out the question he has written in the chat box. How do you explain the trachea shift in the bilateral diseases?
So here the my findings in the right side, I had findings almost from the upper all area was involved, and in the left side it was only in the lower area. So we can explain the mediastinal shift there, sir.
So what are the different forces involved to explain the tracheal shift?
On one side there is fibrosis, and second side pushing and pulling, these are the two factors which define the trachea shift. Which is more, which is less, that decide, and it is tug of war between right and left lung, and it is a relative phenomena. So in particular case, by examination and everything, there is more pushing and less pulling, and of course both forces acting towards the left side. That's why we told that examination wise it is trachea shift there.
Okay, thank you, sir. Dr. Ratnesh, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, congratulations to the Department of Respiratory Medicine for a wonderful presentation. I would like to ask, what are the I have two questions. What are the indications of bullectomy in this particular case? And second thing, what is the evidence-based medicine means for pirfenidone antifibrotic use in this patient? Thank you.
So your first question. Thank you, sir, for your question. The first part of the question, what is the indication of bullectomy? At this particular point, with the current health situation, he is not a candidate for bullectomy. If a simple bullectomy is only, it is done if there is a localized bulla, which is well defined. But in our case, it is extensive involvement, and he is not a candidate for simple bullectomy at this particular point of time. But we are waiting, and we are in a period of wait and watch. So as I have explained earlier, maybe there is shrinkage of hair and there is resolution and autobullectomy, and we'll assess at that time, and then we can say whether you can go for a bullectomy, pneumonectomy, or a segmentectomy at that point of time. Right at this point, he is not a candidate for bullectomy because of an extensive involvement. The second part of your question, sir, what is the indication of antifibrotic perforadone? So this is a debatable topic. Actually, there is no evidence as such. There is no randomized control trial till now for the use of antifibrotics like as nintedanib or perforadone. But at the same time, in the certain case studies have shown that in patients with high risk factors, that is the patient in an elderly age group or patient with comorbidities, patient requiring domiciliary oxygen, or patient who had a history of NIV or HFNC and ICU stay, these are high risk of people, and these people can go into a progressive type of fibrosis in the COVID, and in such people there is no hardened we can try for nintedanib and perforadone, and the studies are more promising with nintedanib. But in this patient, he was initially on nintedanib. The why we kept change him on perforadone was that he was also an anticoagulant. So the recent studies have shown that in patients with nintedanib, there is high chances of bleeding if it is given along with anticoagulants. So in this patient, so we changed him on perforadone and we started.
Okay. I request Professor S.K. Singh, sir, you can unmute and ask your question.
Yeah, the short question, a good presentation, very short question. What was the need of doing IL-6 and CRP when it was a post-COVID phase? Yes, which suggests only ongoing inflammation during the active disease.
Yes. Thank you, sir, for your question. So the need of doing IL-6 and other inflammatory markers in post-COVID is that these markers are clinical predictors. So these markers, the level of elevation of these markers gives an idea of how much fibrosis or thrombosis the patient can go into. So this is a hyperinflammatory, viral viremia is over. Now the patient is in post-COVID, and the post-COVID, the problem is mainly due to this persisting hyperinflation. So these are the clinical, these markers like IL-6, ferritin, DRC, D-dimer, CRP, they are the markers of inflammation, which gives us an idea that this could be a high-risk patient. He can go into develop fibrosis or thrombosis, and in this patient we can give antifibrotics, as I've explained, sir, and a prophylactic anticoagulation. So that was a point rationally of doing
D-dimer is okay. I think one parameter would be enough. So many, it will not be cost effective to do so many parameters.
Yes.
And choosing the therapy based on one parameter and choose one therapy, that's okay. So many parameters.
Noted.
Yes, sir, point noted, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So thank you, Professor G.N. Srivastava, sir. Now we are moving to second presentation. It's from Faculty of Dental Sciences. So I request the moderator, Dr. Akhilesh Kumar Singh, you can initiate the second presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Abhishek.
Thank you, sir.
Very good. Director, sir, and the whole IMS family. Today, on behalf of Faculty of Dental Science, we are going to discuss a case of correction of gross dentofacial deformity with an interdisciplinary approach. So normally we get the dental malocclusion, which is treated under the unit of orthodontics, and sometimes in 2-5% of the population, we get the gross dentofacial deformity in which the underlying alveolar bone or jaw bone, that is maxilla and mandible, is also involved. And it may be a vertical maxillary access or a vertical maxillary deficiency or anterior-posterior access like that, or retrognathism or prognathism. So in these cases, we require an interdisciplinary approach, a surgical intervention by the unit of oral and maxillofacial surgery, and the orthodontic approach by the unit of orthodontics. So this is the case in which both the interventions were done. So we are going to start with that. Today we have as a moderator myself, Dr. Akhilesh Kumar Singh from the unit of oral and maxillofacial surgery, and Dr. Vipul Kumar Sharma, he is my co-moderator from the unit of orthodontics. Apart from that, we have blessings of our unit head, Professor Naresh Kumar Sharma sir, with us, and the presentation will be presented by the JR3, Dr. Mehul Shashikant Hirani, and we'll start with the presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, respected director, sir, esteemed faculty members, respected teachers, my seniors and dear juniors. Today, I am going to present a case on the correction of gross dentofacial deformity by an interdisciplinary approach. To discuss the case, a 24-year-old female came to the Department for Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery Unit with the chief complaint of forwardly placed upper front lip. She, on examination, she had mesocephalic head, leptoproscopic face. She had incompetent lips of 14 mm with excessive gingival display of 7 mm on smiling. She had an acute nasolabial angle with flat nasolabial folds. Her profile was convex with posterior divergent face, and her mentolabial sulcus was average. She had high clinical Frankfurt mandibular plane angles, as which was evident in the lateral profile view. Her intraoral clinical photographs showed malocclusion with a high arch palate and constricted palate region with crowding in anterior region, anterior proclined incisors, and missing permanent mandibular right and left first molars. Patient was advised lateral cephalogram to know the discrepancy in anteroposterior plane of the maxilla and mandible, which was advised for cephalometric analysis for orthognathic surgery. On the cephalometric analysis, a cranial base was measured with the normal values of this respective geographical location and demographic data. The first was articulare to nasion. Articulare is a landmark on the posterior border of ramus to the junction of basi occiput to the nasion, which was 72 mm. Second measurement was PTM to nasion, which determined anterior cranial base, which was 53 mm, which was within the normal range of 50.9 plus minus 3 mm. The third was posterior cranial base, which was defined by articulare to PTM point, which was 31 mm, which was also within range. The fourth point was NA nasion to point A, which is the deepest point on the anterior curvature of the maxillary anterior aspect of the maxillary dentoalveolar segment to the pogonion, which is the prominent part of the chin, which was approximately 10 degrees. So an inference which we made was normal posterior position of mandible in the cranial base and facial convexity. In the maxilla, the cephalometric analysis showed anterior maxillary height of 55 mm, which was more on the higher side. The posterior maxillary height, which was 47 mm, which was within the normal values, and the effective maxillary length was 51 mm. So inference which we got was increased anteriorly vertical maxillary height. Now, position of maxilla, which was determined by Sela, Nasion, and point A angle, which was 85 degrees, which was slightly on the higher side, and nasion to point A, which was plus 1 mm. So the inference was to normal position of maxilla. Now, cephalometric analysis of dentoalveolar relation. So anterior dentoalveolar height, which was measured from upper incisor to nasal flow, which was 33 mm, which was more on the higher side. And the posterior dentoalveolar height was 25 mm, which was measured from the upper first molar to the nasal flow. So inference which we got was increased dentoalveolar height of maxilla anteriorly and which was normal posteriorly. In mandible, the size of mandible, which was measured by ramus height from the point articulare to gonion, which is 43.5 mm in our case, which was within the normal range, and the body length, which was measured from gonion to gnathion, which was 75 mm and which was also within the normal range. Inference which we got was normal length of ramus and body of mandible. The position of mandible, which was decided by SNB angle, which is cella nasion to point B angle, which is 82 degrees, which was within the normal range, and NB, linear measurement, which was minus 5 mm, which was also within the normal value. So inference which we got was the normal position of mandible. The dentalveolar relations which we inferred from the cephalometry was lower incisor to mandibular plane, which was 46 mm, which is on the higher side. So inference was she had proclined mandibular incisors. And orientation of mandible, angle of mandible, which was measured by articulare to gonion and gnathion, which is 125 degrees, which was within the range. And mandibular plane angle, which was 29 degrees. So the inference which we made was clockwise rotation of mandible with increased lower anterior facial height. The chin was also measured with cephalometry by the parameters nasion to pogonion, which was minus 4 mm, which was slightly, which was within the range, and BN perpendicular. So the inference which we got was normal mandible with chin. So diagnosis which we made was skeletal class 2 malocclusion with ANB angle of 3 degrees and dentoalveolar class 1 type 2 malocclusion with missing permanent molars on mandible bilaterally and protruded upper and lower lips. So treatment plan which was decided by orthodontics team and maxillofacial unit team. So which was first was pre-surgical orthodontics by alignment and leveling, positioning of teeth over the basal bone, and elimination of dental compensations. Third was correction of rotated teeth and divergence of roots of adjacent to the surgical sites. Orthognathic surgery, which was decided, having extraction of upper right and left first premolars with anterior segmental osteotomy and superior repositioning of maxilla 4 mm and setback of 5 mm to close the extraction spaces of first premolars. And extraction of lower right and left first premolars with anterior subapical osteotomy of mandible with 5 mm of setback of anterior dentoalveolar portion to close the extraction spaces. Post-surgical orthodontics, which was advised to the patient for finishing and settling of the malocclusion, root paralleling and marginal ridge leveling and perfect cuspal digitation of all the teeth. And the final treatment, which was prosthetic replacement of the missing teeth 3-6 and 4-6. In pre-surgical orthodontics, which was done by the Department of Orthodontics, the criteria we have already mentioned to correct the arch form and the correction of rotation and crowding, which was done, as we can see in this photographs. Lateral cephalogram, which was done by orthodontics department. This is the lateral cephalogram showing the patient's clinical status. And patient was advised orthopentomogram. This is the pre-surgical orthopentogram, which is showing the clinical aspect of the patient. The model surgery, which was planned by a semi-adjustable articulator, the cast, which was the negative replica of the patient's intraoral clinical mandible and maxilla, which was mounted on an articulator, which is a jaw stimulator, and multiple marks, vertical lines, which are denoting on the first molar, first premolar and canine, which is marked, and a mock surgery was performed. As we can see here clearly, the mock surgery in this photograph, which in see the outline of the first premolar, which has to be extracted during the orthognathic surgery. And after surgery, the splint, after osteotomy cuts are made on the cast, performing mock surgery, these casts were placed in a predetermined position, and this position was fixed with the help of wax and a occlusal splint to guide the new occlusal position was made with the help of occlusal splint, which is to be used in the final surgery, which was performed on the patient. This is the preoperative frontal view of the patient, and the clinical features which we already discussed are visible on this patient. You can see the gummy smile of the patient with excessive display of upper front teeth. This is the preoperative profile view showing acute nasolabial angle, shallow mentolabial sulcus, and the excessive display of incisors and gummy smile on lateral profile view. So operative plan which was done was mandibular anterior subapical osteotomy. The mandibular anterior subapical osteotomy, this is the picture which is showing the procedure of mandibular anterior subapical osteotomy. This is the intraoperative procedure, which is also known as Colles procedure. A vestibular incision was given in the mandibular anterior region and the submucosa and the mentalis fibers were cut from the 5mm from the mucogingival junction, where preserving the bilateral mental nerves, and osteotomy cut is marked 5mm apical to the mandibular roots. And these osteotomy cuts are widened, and after that first premolars on right and left side were extracted. A submucosal tunneling was done on the buccal aspect, and the cuts which were we determined on the mock surgery are done on vertically on bilateral premolars. After that, a horizontal cut which is made alongside the inferior border of this cut, after the segment was mobilized, and this segment was positioned into new occlusal set with the help of occlusal splint. After performing mock surgery on the mandibular side, we performed surgery on the maxilla. Maxillary subapical osteotomy is similar to the mandibular one, but as it involves the nasal floor, the procedure somewhat differs. This is the photograph which is showing the bilateral premolars, first premolars which were extracted, and the whole anterior maxillary dentoalveolar unit was cut with the help of anterior horizontal and vertical cuts. This is the intraoperative view photograph showing Cooper's procedure, which is anterior maxillary subapical osteotomy cuts, and horizontal cuts are made through the piriform aperture, which were above 5mm above the roots of the maxillary teeth. And after that, vertical cuts are made through the extraction sockets. Palatal cuts were made through by making a submucosal tunnels, and thus the whole dentalveolar segment was mobilized. After mobilizing, the mobilized segment of maxilla and mandible were placed into the new occlusal guide with the help of occlusal splint, which was made earlier by the mock surgery. And then the fixation of these units were made with the help of mini plates. The 1.5 mm mini plate system was used for fixation of maxilla, and 2 mm mini plate system was used in the mandible. This is the postoperative frontal and profile view of the patient, and which is clearly visible the reduction in the gummy smile with less incisor exposure, with prominent nasolabial folds, and the improvement in the mentolabial and nasolabial angles. This is the postoperative photograph of the patient, which is showing the intraoral findings, which was further followed by post-surgical orthodontic treatment by the orthodontic team. This is a comparison between the pre and post-operative lateral cephalogram, which is showing improvement in the profile with reduction in the overjet and overbite of this patient in the lateral cephalogram. This is a postoperative OPG showing the position of the dental alveolar segments. This is a postoperative photograph, frontal view, which is showing the patient's smile, which is the indicating towards the satisfaction of the patient. The correction of gummy smile leads to the more happy face of the patient, and this is what patient needed. This is a lateral profile of the patient. To further discuss this topic, bimaxillary protrusion is a condition characterized by protrusive dentoalveolar portion of maxillary and mandibular arches with proclined upper and lower incisors and increased proclivity of the lips. It is commonly seen in African American and Asian populations. The clinical features are convex facial profile, protrusive upper and lower lips, lip incompetence more than 4 mm, excessive exposure of the front teeth, which can be either maxillary or mandibular, and gummy smile, which may be a problem for most of the patients. And due to excessive strain of the perioral musculature, mentalis strain is one of the features. Bimaxillary protrusion in Caucasian, a cephalometric study of the morphologic features, an article by Keating PJ in British Journal of Orthodontics, which showed a short posterior cranial base, longer and more prognathic maxilla, shorter ramus, and long body of mandible, mild class 2 skeletal pattern, smaller upper and posterior face height, and diverging facial planes with prominent soft tissue profile and with a low lip line. The management. The first priority should be patient's main concern and aesthetic consideration. So patient, we should guide the patient to have realistic expectations. As we can see, that Tom Cruise is having midline shift, but this midline shift is not discernible by the others. So the being what you are can be the realistic expectation by the patient. After orthognathic surgery, this female can't become an actress like Deepika Padukone, but we have to be in the realistic way. The routine practice is the orthodontic camouflage with extraction of four premolars followed by retraction or uprighting of anteriors. So in case of moderate to severe skeletal discrepancy, we have to proceed to orthognathic surgery. In cases of sagittal access, bijo or upper and lower jaw surgeries with anterior subapical osteotomy is the initial treatment, followed by, if vertical access is there, Lefort 1 osteotomy with superior impaction followed by bilateral sagittal split osteotomy can be the treatment with more than 5 mm of discrepancy. And genioplasty, which is the surgical recontouring of the bony chin, is reserved for the future treatments. Pre-surgical assessment should include clinical examination, patient's desires, radiographic analysis, prediction tracing through the cephalogram or through photographic analysis of this patient through various computer softwares, or preoperative model analysis with the help of dental models, and mock surgery on model and surgical planes, which leads to improved patient's treatment. To conclude, surgical intervention is required in cases of severe skeletal discrepancy, and patient's desire and realistic expectation are the most important. Proper preoperative assessment and planning with orthodontic team is necessary. Miracles can happen in cases of skeletal discrepancies and dentofacial malformations. So we have to look at the other side. Comprehensive treatment planning by combined team approach is is needed in most of the cases. Finally, I would like the director sir and the team of this to allow me to present this case in the clinical society meeting today. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. It was really a wonderful presentation and wonderful result which you have shown. The patient smile, the improvement. It was really a very good result is there. So I request Professor Sanjay Gupta, sir, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Thank you, Abhishek. Very nice presentation, and I particularly like your last slide, the slide of conclusion. Look at the other side. What are the complications of this surgery, and how do you counsel the patient? What is the best age for correction, and do you stage this corrective surgery or do you carry it out at one stage? And finally, what is the cost of this procedure? Too many questions. I will repeat them if you are not able to track them. So first question is, what are the complications?
Complications may vary. So it starts from the simply the non-vitality of the tooth. If you cut the bone so close to the tooth apex, then it may lead to the non-vitality of the tooth. Sometimes if you cut the vascular pedicle or the soft tissue on the bilateral aspect of maxilla or mandible, then it may lead to the avascular necrosis of the bone. So you have to be very gentle while cutting the bone. You have to preserve the soft tissue. You have to preserve, you have to be very patient while cutting the bone to preserve the vascularity, because on the one side you are denuding the bone. So on the opposite side, for example, in mandible, we are denuding the bone on the buccal aspect. So on the lingual aspect, we have to be very gentle to preserve the vascularity of the mandible and the maxillary segment. Apart from that, sir, if you are doing leaf 41 osteotomy and the bilateral sagittal split osteotomy, then the relapses are also seen in these cases. So relapse, post-surgical relapse is also one of the complications of these surgeries.
What is, how do you counsel the patient? I mean, you talked about realistic expectations. Sir, so what counseling do you carry out?
Counseling can be carried out on the basis of the clinical picture of the patient. We take the clinical picture of the patient. Now we have softwares, various softwares like Dolphin software, in which we can change the picture on the basis of the post-surgical results. We can modify the results and we can show the patient that post-surgical, if you will carry out these surgical procedures, your look will be changed. So these types of mock surgeries on the model, we can show the patient that the post-operative results are like this. So like this, we do the counseling of the patient. Sometimes, because it is a long procedure, we need a patience of the patient as well as our team, because it takes around 1 and 1.5 hour by the orthodontics team to correct the malocclusion and to align the teeth. Then after that, it is the team of the surgery which performs the surgery. After the surgery, it takes around 3 to 6 months for the post-operative rehabilitation of the patient. So it's a procedure of around 1.5 to 2 years. So it needs a lot of patience of the patient as well as the surgical and the orthodontic team to carry out these results.
What is the best age for correction?
So normally the facial growth for the maxilla, it is post-pubertal is the period, and for the mandible, it is up to the 18 years of the age. So post 18 years, we can perform these kinds of surgeries when the growth pattern is completed.
And what is the approximate cost?
Cost is not the question of matter. It's the matter of the patience by which the patient, because the suffering, it's almost 2 years procedure. So it involves the both the social, psychological, and because the patient is coming, if it is from the local Varanasi, then it is for the patient. Suppose the patient is coming from Ghazipur, patient is coming from Mirzapur, then it definitely includes its transportation cost, the patients of the family members. So it's a really, for the surgical cost, it is simply a surgical procedure. We need a scalpel, few sutures, and few bone cutting burrs and plates. So it is not the cost, surgical cost. For the orthodontics, we need the braces experts. They place the braces. So it is almost, if you calculate the armamentarium, it will include around 25,000 to 30,000. But that doesn't matter. It matters the patience of the patient, that for the 2 years he is coming for the hospital and regular appointments, post-operative appointments. So that is important.
Thank you,
Dr. Akhilesh. I think it's a really wonderful presentation, and the important slide, which I, the patient satisfaction is the parameter for your success for the doctors.
Actually, I wanted to show the eyes of the patient, but due to some legal reasons, we could not show the eyes. You can see the difference in the eyes of the patient pre-operative and post-operative.
Yes, I have.
The level of confidence she gains after surgery.
Thank you once again. There is one question which has been asked by Professor Madhukar Rai, sir, and that is for the first presentation. So we have like 2-3 minutes left. I request Professor Madhukar Rai, sir, you can unmute yourself and ask your question. Otherwise, I will read from my side.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Sir has asked, is it possible to predict the fibrosis in a COVID and what is the role of antifibrotic therapy? I think the role of antifibrotic therapy has already been discussed. So is it possible to predict the fibrosis in a COVID patient?
Thank you, sir, for your question. To predict the fibrosis, sir, we are having certain risk factors. If the patient is having a higher age group, or the patient with higher comorbidities, or the patient who was hospitalized for a longer period of time, who required domiciliary oxygen on discharge, requiring more amount of NIV and HFNC. And these are the patients who are at higher risk of developing fibrosis. And there are certain ventilator associated injuries also associated with fibrosis. And there are certain inflammatory causes.
These parameters are not really validated. Means there is no hard and fast correlation between these parameters with the fibrosis. So I think that discussion will go a long way. I request our honorable director, sir. I request you for your comments.
Thank you, Vishek. Nice presentations. First case also, this is interesting case. 35-year young male, no comorbidities post-COVID, having such a huge disease, especially this emphysematous bully. But the main thing is it was very well presented and very confidently. What's your name? Aparna?
Yes, sir.
Very confidently you took the questions, and that's more important. Whatever the case is there, though it is interesting case, but to handle the questions and answer, so very confident. Congratulations, and well presented, well prepared. Even the coordinators for this case, the whole department, TB and respiratory diseases department, so deserve the kudos for that. So well treated also. Second case also from the department of oral and maxillofacial surgery as well as orthodontics, that's the dental sciences. This is more of a cosmetic, but very well done surgery. We could see the smile. That is, as we see in the advertisements, that before this, after that, weight reducing or other surgeries, similarly picture was there. There's a lot of difference in the this photographs images. So this well done job, though it's a time consuming, almost 2 years, as you told, one has to have the patience, and patient has to have patience. So this is very important. So very well done procedure, though the surgical part I personally could not understand much, frankly telling, but the outcome was fantastic. So congratulations both the departments for doing wonderful presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think you have a message very important point, patience. Patience is very important for everyone. And once again, thank you everyone for joining this Clinical Society meeting, and see you at the next CSM. Bye.